Greetings, everyone, and welcome to Travels with Spy. I ended up taking an Amtrak train out of Boston on my way home from PAX East this year, which gave me a relatively unique opportunity to cover the onboard accommodations. And rather than just show all of you a coach seat, which is nothing particularly special, I opted instead to reserve what they call a roomette, which is essentially a tiny private cabin that technically can sleep two, but is really best suited for one. This is the corridor outside the cabin, and the car to which I was assigned was directly behind the locomotive, which, as you can see, has seen better days. And I'm glad I wasn't assigned the cabin closest to the locomotive, because the smell of diesel fumes at this spot in the car was quite overpowering. But this is the cabin. It has a door that completely seals it off from the rest of the train, so you do have complete privacy if you want it. And there's a bunk up at the top, that's what that thing with the handle is, so that if you do have a second person traveling with you, they can sleep separately from you, although it's quite tight up there. You'll see that in a moment when I pull the bunk down. But the staff on the train were fantastic. However, the equipment that they had to work with was maybe modern by 1970s standards, but a little bit behind. You can see that the sink only actually drains when you fold it back into the wall. And down here, well, the toilet in the cabin is an interesting idea, but heaven help you if you do actually have two people in this cabin, because this would be a very awkward experience under such circumstances. Fortunately, the train does have other bathrooms. There are public bathrooms, I guess you'd call them, that are accessible to every passenger. And fortunately, there are blinds you can draw across the windows of the cabin. But overall, the layout of these cabins is kind of baffling to me. Again, it might have been modern in the 70s, but if you've ever ridden, for example, the Shinkansen in Japan, or maybe an overnight train in Western Europe, these facilities are a little bit dated. And I've covered some of the trains here in Germany many years ago. Those are fairly old videos now, but you can go back and watch them if you want to compare. Here we're just leaving South Station. And I was very lucky that I got to the train when I did, because it left about 3 minutes after I boarded. So unfortunately, I didn't have a lot of time to get exterior footage, and I didn't want to take the risk of having the train leave while I was standing outside like an idiot filming it. This is another design element that kind of baffles me. If you're traveling alone, the checkers table and the little fold-out leafs are kind of superfluous, and if you're not traveling alone, you have to bring your own checkers pieces. They don't provide them. This is the fold-down bunk, and I'm not sure how much weight it can actually support, but it's, I guess, nice to have if you're traveling with a second person, but the space up here is really tight. I barely have room to maneuver, and just moving the camera around, standing on top of the toilet, which folds down into a step so that you can actually reach the top bunk, is a tricky proposition with the train moving and swaying back and forth. I had to hold on to the bunk with my left hand and hold the camera with my right hand, so it was a little bit tricky maneuvering up here. And I didn't actually intend to film my feet at this point. I just had to angle the camera downward to get down from the step and not hook it on the bunk on the way down. The bottom two seats do actually fold out into a bunk as well, and the process to do that is kind of tricky. You have to pull a bunch of levers and apply a fairly significant amount of force to the backrests in order to fold them down. And then when I finally did succeed in getting the bottom bunk folded down, I ran into a rather unexpected problem, which also speaks to the datedness of the facilities here. And I mean, if it's just one person using the cabin, you can actually stretch out fairly well, although you don't have a lot of room to either side. But I discovered, rather to my dismay, when setting up the bottom bunk, that the bunks are kind of held together with popsicle sticks and glue. This cushion literally just fell off the wall, at which point I realized it was held on by a couple of hooks and maybe a little bit of tape. So this is it was fine. I just put it back on the wall and hopefully nobody noticed. Now, as to the food, I rather got cheated here, because what's supposed to happen is they'll serve a hot meal at a designated time, and I wasn't on the train long enough to still be there at the time that they served this meal. The meal was included in the price of my ticket, but I had to bring food from the food court at South Station because I wasn't on the train long enough to actually be able to take advantage of the complimentary meal they provided. Mind you, Amtrak food is comparable basically to airline food. It's pretty much that same level of quality, but I still feel cheated that I didn't get to take advantage of the meal that I ended up paying for. So I ended up getting these really sad sandwiches from, well, sandwich and essentially just a croissant from the food court at South Station. And I had to tide myself over just with that on the way. It didn't end up being nearly enough, so I went to the dining car. And if you're eating outside of the appointed meal time, this is basically the most that you can get from the dining car. Just one of these microwave rip and dip cheese rolls. Literally, they just microwave this in front of you. So this is what you have to look forward to if you ride Amtrak. Maybe one day I'll cover the Acela, because that's an entirely different experience. It's a very, very different train with different amenities. But as it is, I hope you've all enjoyed this, and I look forward to seeing you next time. Take care, everyone.